because that's what it is. It's the morning, right? Hello. I'm from California, so it's like, what? It's like 9 o'clock for me, but I'm pretty lazy, so usually I'm not up by this time anyways. So this is like, I think this panel was just my name on it, and I was talking to this guy, Zach Aguilar.
Are you Hispanic?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm Ricardo Contreras. He asked me to tag along. I'm an audio engineer for Sentai Filmworks. I think I've worked on pretty much everything they put out for the past 4 years. So, yeah. This guy's pretty cool. He's been really
Yeah, we just met each other last night, and I was like, I kind of don't want to do a panel alone tomorrow morning, so if you could just tag along with me, and he's like, it'll be chill. Did you guys get tickets for coming? The little raffle tickets? That's so cool because you can get like a Switch or the
SNES.
Yeah, the SNES Classic.
I've been trying to buy that thing for a while now, and I can't find it anywhere.
Well, it's so hard, and I will say this. Isn't this comic sponsored by Think Geek?
I think so.
Think Geek.
Yeah.
Because I actually got mine from Think Geek. I remember I was on their website, and I kept refreshing the page for like an hour or two, like randomly, and then it just opened up.
That's
like
awesome.
It just opened up, like something like just, you know, the gates were open, and I went in, I bought one really fast, and then apparently they sold out within like 40 seconds or something. So I like went in and I used the Google Chrome autofill info thing, and I just got one. So, and then I ended up giving it to my dad, because that was his like. His system that he played, and I was like, hey, Dad, like, check this out.
Did you ever actually play that?
Yeah, I did. I did.
So, is it as awesome as you remember it, or is it just a nostalgia, and then you start playing, and you're like, man, this sucks, or was it good?
I mean, I think it's, like, I still think it's pretty cool. Like, every time I play, like, Donkey Kong Country, or, like, Super Mario World, I get, like, flashbacks to, like, you know, I don't know, like, when I was, like, 6 or 7 years old, and I'm on this old couch that we used to have, and I was like drinking eggnog and stuff because it was like during Christmas, you know, like I just have this like weird memories, but I still think like I can still appreciate it for what it is. But then I look at all these other new games, and I'm like, wow, has technology like really changed?
What's your what would you say your favorite game right now is?
Right now,
yeah.
Probably the game I play the most is Overwatch.
We were talking about gaming last night, and I saw a different side of Zach. He's like, once you talk gaming, he gets really aggressive, and it's all competitive.
Yeah.
And he just wants to show you that he can kick your butt. Yeah.
I'm a soldier main, and if you take him away from me, then I will find you and do something. Is this on film? Like, you can know.
Yeah, right.
So, yeah.
Anybody else here play Overwatch? Yeah?
Oh,
nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Sweet. Yeah, I remember D.Va, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who here plays as Bastion?
I play as Bastion.
Yeah, yeah, right? It's just, getting up against the corner and just nailing everybody.
I mean, I'll do it to troll sometimes, and then there's that new point, what's it called? Like, Lunar Space Colony?
Yeah.
And sometimes, like, our team will go, like, double shields, they'll go, like, Reinhardt or Risa. And then I'll be like, okay, I'm gonna play Bastion, nobody else play Bastion because you guys aren't gonna be able to do as good as I'm gonna do, as him, obviously. So, you know, so I just like, I set up and I'm like, you guys, you know, get in front of me, one shield in the front, one shield, this is like a junk wrap, one shield in the back, so like his little bombs don't bang back and hit me, and then we just kinda dominate.
That's awesome. See, I'm playing that and Battlefield 1. I can't stop playing that game, it's so...
Battlefield 1, when did that one come out?
Anybody here know? I can't remember.
Is that like one of the, that's like one of the, that's not like a...
It's a newer one, yeah.
Oh, it's a newer one. Okay.
But I think maybe a year ago now or something.
Yeah. I was thinking about buying the new Call of Duty, but then I like looked online and everyone and their mother was like refunding it or something for some reason. So I'm like, okay, it's probably not that.
It's basically the same just with the World War II skin.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So.
Do you like it?
Yeah, how is it?
That's what I thought, man. That's what Call of Duty does. It's like every single time it comes out, I'm like, I'm not gonna buy it, not this year, I'm done. And then I see some trailer, I'm like, man, that looks so good. But so, and then I finally came, I came into the World War II one, but the one before.
Like, was it Black Ops?
No, it was the one that...
Oh, yeah, Infinity War, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't cave for that one. I played the beta, and I was like, this is basically like Black Ops 3.0.5.2. I don't know, what Black Ops did we get to? I can't remember. 3? Yeah, so it was like 3.2, that's what it felt like. And it was just, oh, okay, you're in space now, and you're floating.
And there's okay. A lot of high jumps and models. It doesn't feel like Call of Duty anymore. It's more like we're flying around shooting people. Like, I remember, what was the other one? I just remember playing Black Ops, like, just the first one a lot. Like, all my friends, we would play zombies all the time.
Yeah.
I think, what was, like, the best Call of Duty? What was it, like, World at War or Modern Warfare? What am I thinking? What was the, like, I had a favorite one, but I can't remember.
My all-time favorite, I don't know about all you guys, but I like 4, the first Modern Warfare. Yeah, it was just Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare, and it was, I think it was about the time when online gaming started really becoming a hardcore thing, and I just remember how simple it was, and that was the beauty of it, is that it was just simple, you try and get the other person, and that was it. Then, as the games progressed, they started adding so many things, and Modern Warfare 2, oh man, that nuke.
The
nuke killstreak, I hated that so much for that. Damn. Passion.
In Modern Warfare, did they have the grenade launcher? Like the
Nuke 2?
Yeah, I remember that. And like people were using that on me all the time, and I was just like, okay, if you can't beat them, go ahead. Then I started using it too, and it was just like everyone was using it. Yeah, it was something else. But, yeah.
So, have you been to Texas often? Is this your first time?
This is like my second time in Texas. I came down like in January to visit family, and then I did some stuff with Funimation, and then I kind of like went home like a week later. So
yeah. So who? Obviously, you guys know who he is. What's your favorite role that you've seen him in?
Nobody knows.
Nobody knows? What roles have you been on? Tell us.
Oh, hey, that is so sick.
Stand up and show him real quick.
Yeah, that is so cool. Look at that.
That's awesome. Did you make that yourself, or did you buy it, or what's up? That's cool,
I bought it, and then I cut out the seam on the shirt of the art.
That is awesome. Sweet.
Damn.
Yeah. So I play some roles, Genos in One Punch Man, I play Takaki in Gundam Iron-Blooded Orphans, which is on Toonami right now. I play Arthur Pendragon in The Seven Deadly Sins, which is on Netflix. And then a really recent one, Tolkien in Sword Art Online too. And then like my most recent role is a character called Sieg in the Fate series called Fate Apocrypha. And that is also on Netflix. So, woo!
Netflix is starting to do a lot of anime.
Yeah. It's interesting like to see the stuff that kind of comes through and see what they're like working on, you know? And then they're doing like some, and sometimes I think they do like a 3D anime stuff too, which is a little weird.
Who here likes that? Who here doesn't like that? The 3D anime style is coming up on Netflix.
Like, I mean, it's not horrible, but it's like, I guess it's a really different change, you know, compared to what I'm sure a lot of people are used to.
It's weird, because like, I feel like they're starting to do it to save money, maybe, on things, because it's so easy to people get information now, and it saves a lot of time. But I feel like a lot of these 3D things coming out, they're very, like, very little rendering, very cheaply looking. I have a problem with that. I want it to look nice. And that's what I've always liked about anime is that it's its own form of art. By the way, I'm a dope fan. I hate some. Reason being, I don't feel like I should read cartoons. I want to freaking watch the animation, enjoy the art style, and get the story in. And that's it. But
it's like, well, it's like when people ask me, you know, like, oh, you're a voice actor. You know, do you prefer like English dubs or subs? And I'm like, well, you know, like the dubs kind of get you the work. So I mean, like, yeah, that's kind of what I do. so maybe it was done.
Yeah.
I mean, go ahead.
Zach, you might be able to answer. I was kind of wondering, as you work on some of these things, some that Netflix is bringing over with their dubbing, are they partnering with Funimation to get the dubs done? Or, because it's like, I mean, some of the sins, there's so many Funimation voice actors doing that.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not entirely sure. I know that something really interesting that happened not too long ago was Mob Psycho 100, and that was a Funimation title. But we actually, everybody who worked on that actually recorded that in LA, and I believe the reason why we did that was, like, I think Crunchyroll, because Funimation Crunchyroll, like, did something, right? Like, they kind of, like, merged a little bit, or they were having some like merger, and then they decided to record it in LA for some reason, and something like that. But I'm not entirely sure about like Funimation coming in and being involved with the Netflix stuff, though.
Yeah, strange. For I would say I think it's similar for voice actors, but as an audio engineer, we don't know much about those deals. We kind of like we're told this is your next project, do it. And it's like, okay.
Yeah, sometimes people will like, yeah, we'll hear like, you know, something or like, or I'll go ask the casting director a little bit more about the show or who's like producing it and whatnot, but other than that, I usually don't.
To me, it feels like it's companies kind of, at least the big companies like Netflix obviously has a lot of money, so it's kind of like they're, a lot of these companies are starting to come together and collaborating more with each other and paying each other to like, hey, you're over in Houston, we want that actor, so let's have Sentai do it. Or, hey, it's Dallas, they have those actors over there, let's have Funimation do it. And,
yeah.
And I think that's great, because why not?
Yeah.
More work for everybody, you get a wider variety of voices now too, and it makes it less hard to achieve a beautiful project, you know? But,
yeah, definitely.
By the way, if you guys have any questions, please raise your hands.
Yeah, anything
any comments at all, too, yeah.
What console do you play on?
Console? Well, for the most part, I play on a PC, but, like, usually I have a Xbox One and PS4 and a Switch and a Wii.
So you have everything.
Never mind. there goes my paychecks, buying everything for those systems and... I don't know, I play about everything, pretty much. Like, I don't really play my Wii or my Wii U anymore. I've been playing the Switch more. And then I just PC a lot, and then I'll play, you know, Xbox One, and sometimes, like, PS4, something, if it's, like, Final Fantasy, you know, so.
See, I just started PC gaming for the first time this past January.
Oh, do you play Overwatch on PC?
Yeah.
Oh, sweet.
I love Overwatch so much.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had it on PS4 only because I gave it on PS4. I used to be an Xbox guy, but then we all know what happened with Xbox One when they were introducing. It's like, sorry, I can't do that. It's all ages. Anyways, so and I was like, screw it, I'm going to Sony. And I'm kind of happy I did that because they have really awesome exclusives.
Yeah.
Holy cow, Last of Us. And oh my goodness, if you haven't played Last of Us, it's so good. That's so. I forget. I was tearing up at the very beginning, you know, and that happens. I don't want to spoil it to anybody who hasn't seen it. If you haven't seen it, check it out on YouTube. It's a great intro to the game, and it hooked me from there. But yeah, no, I tried out PC because I was trying to build like a new rig to be able to mix and do audio engineering stuff from my home instead of having to go to studios all the time. And so I was like, do I spend $3,000 on a brand new Mac Pro, or do I build my own PC?
It's only one answer.
Yeah, and so I looked it up. I started looking up to see how hard it would be, and it was actually fairly simple. All you gotta do is Google things nowadays.
Well, same with me. I knew nothing about like PCs or computers. Yeah. I watched like how to build your own PC video on YouTube. Made my own PC.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow,
that's awesome.
I can game and play things on like super high frame rates and ultra settings. I'm like, what are ultra, like after you come from console, you look at like ultra graphics, you're like, wow, what have I been missing?
Yeah, you know, seriously. The hardest thing for me was the aiming with the mouse because it's so sensitive.
You really gotta like find the right, the right like DPI for your mouse and like practice with it.
Yeah, but now I've been doing it. I bought all my stuff during the Black Friday deals, and then it finally arrived like around January or so, and and that's why I built it. So I think I got it for like 1350 without the monitor.
Yeah.
And I looked at the specs for everything that I have, and it would have cost me around $3,000 to buy an Apple computer.
Wow.
And I love it. I'm using Pro Tools on my rig at my house, and it runs beautifully. I've always heard like that there's like compatibility issues with it and stuff, but man, it runs way. My computer runs better than the computers that we have at Students.
Are you on are you on Windows 10?
Yeah, the 10, the Pro.
Yeah. Well, like, I remember a while ago, it was when, like, Windows 8 just came out, and that's when I really started getting into PC gaming, and I remember, like, trying to put my Pro Tools on that thing, and it had so many, like, compatibility, like, issues and extra things you had to download for it, and it just wouldn't work, and then at the time, I don't think Microsoft had the option to, like, you know, like, downgrade the Windows, like, you know, 7 if you need to you know, make sure your stuff can run. Now I think they have like, an option or something like that, like, where you can actually downgrade, but...
Yeah, you can downgrade, or you can I got 10, I think it's called 10 Pro.
Yeah.
And the reason being is it doesn't update as quickly as the regular one does. Because that's what messes up a lot of these professional softwares to record and all these things.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm still trying to figure out how to turn my updates completely off. I don't need any more.
We got to talk about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. Anyways, PC Master Race, I totally get it now. Yeah.
What's up? How do you start with
that? I guess I'll go back to the roots, is that when I was younger, I was like, 6 or 7 years old, and my mom randomly decided, like, hey, you know, my son's outgoing, so like every other, you know, California mom, my son should be an actor. And so then she would, you know, she'd drive me up to Hollywood when I was kind of like in kindergarten, first grade, and sometimes I would have to go like just at random times during the day, and she would call up my school and be like, hey, yeah, Zach is like, he's really sick, and he's, you know, he's got the flu or something, and then we just like, okay, let's go, son, we're going up to Hollywood. And so then she would drive me up to Hollywood, and I'd start auditioning for, like, on-camera projects, like, for movies and commercials and stuff. She got me, like, signed with an agent. Like, she knew what she was doing. Like, she was, like, on top of it, you know, like, this was, like, she's gonna make it happen. And so while I was doing that, I ended up booking, like, a few little things. I did, like, a jeans commercial. I did a commercial for hotels.com. I played like a karate kid, and I did like some like print and modeling, funny enough, for like there's a place called Cool Cuts, and it's like a children's like haircut place. And they like, and I had like little, I had really like short hair, and like it was and spiky when I was younger, so they like spiked up my hair and put me in that, and I was just kinda like surrounded by a ton of acting stuff for most of my like young
So you've been an actor your whole life,
pretty much. Even when I was that age and I didn't know what I was doing. Like, hey, here's a script. Oh wait, you have an audition for like promotion of Apple Jacks. Like, and then my agent's like right there, and he's like, okay, so you just gotta say this like paragraph. Yeah. You know, and it was tough for me to remember, especially like I'm like, what am I talking about? And like just like, oh yeah, Apple Jacks. You know, I love Apple Jacks, and they're the greatest thing ever, like, in something, and I just remember, like, some weird stuff like that, but I didn't get that one.
Yeah.
So after that, after I was kind of surrounded in acting, I remember it was around the time I was about 12 or 13 years old, and I'd been watching a lot of anime and video games and stuff, and one day I decided to look up like the English dub cast for Naruto, and I never really thought about the actors behind the characters until I looked it up, and I was really surprised that everyone, like, I thought, you know, like, who are all these kids playing these roles, like, and I thought that they would look exactly like the characters. Turns out none of them are children, and they kind of don't like look anything like their roles at all.
Yeah.
Like some people have like a character who has like, you know, black hair and like black eyes or something, and then like it's like, you know, some lady with like blonde hair and blue eyes, and, like, and she just looks nothing. And it was so strange to me, because after being an on-camera actor, I know how important that is like how you look. you know, like sometimes, like
everything I, you know is a lie, by the way.
yeah. So I was like, this is the coolest thing ever because it doesn't matter about how you look.
Yeah.
Like you can just, it's your voice. You know, it's how you sound. And so, so after that, I told my parents that I was really interested in it, and they're like, okay, well, if you're like really serious about acting again, then we're gonna help you find some classes for voiceover, and you can like try to pursue this. So my parents were really cool about that. I know a lot of people don't really have that opportunity with their parents, but because my mom was so into me getting into acting, she just kind of jumped on it. She's like, wow, like he's interested in acting again. Let's do it, you know? And so, so I kind of pursued that a little bit. I took a bunch of, you know, voiceover classes. I wasn't really able to like just jump right into the industry because I found it to be actually very difficult. From what I was used to, like even from, you know, I mean, like I had like theater training at this point, I had a ton of like on camera training at this point too, and I just thought it was really, really hard to like, and then when I went in and I took a dubbing class and I learned how to like, you know, match the, you know, ADR, I was like, this is so difficult, like, because you gotta like read the lines and stuff and then you gotta have to match the clap. But surprisingly, I caught on a lot faster, I think, than most people did because I had took piano lessons for, I've been playing piano for like 10 years at this point when I was younger, so my mom always had me playing an instrument, so I was really good at the timing, even if I'm not always looking at the mouth flap, I just kind of like could hear it and I would know like when to start and stop, I guess. Well, beeps, I know when to start, but you know, when to stop. So at this point, I kind of like hit a block, and I'm like 14 years old, and I'm like so sad. I'm like, I really want to be like a voice actor, and I really want to get into voicing, you know, anime and video games. But why can't I get into the industry? Like it's so tough. It's such like a tight group of people to really like get into. So at Anime Expo in 2014, there was this competition to be a voice actor, and like you pick a script and you go up and read it in front of a bunch of people, and pretty much that's kind of like what, like then they'll call, then the studio who's doing the competition will either like call you in or not call you. And so I remember my friends kind of just like pushed me into the line, like, you know, we're all just kind of like joking, messing around. I'm like, oh my, like there's so many people here, dude, like there's no way I'm gonna, like, you know, this is just like, you know, it's like throwing, I don't even know like what to compare it to, but it's just like, you know, it's like winning the lottery, you know, like there's no way. And so I get in line with my friends and I do the, I read a script, the, like, everybody's like, wow, that was really good. And I kind of like blacked out for the entire thing. I don't remember any of it really. I just remember kind of like shaking a little bit. I was so nervous, like, because especially for voiceover and, you know, to read for like a character and in front of a bunch of people, it's just something I hadn't really done in a while because I took this long break from acting too. And so then I remember a few weeks later, I think I was kind of having like a bad day or something, like, you know, I don't know, somebody stole my candy or whatever. And I get a phone call from them, like, hey, we want to call you back in for another audition to the studio. And I'm like, really? And so I set up a time with them and I go up to Burbank, go into the studio, and I do some more lines for them. I do a general audition, which means you audition for like a ton of different things, like basically things that they've kind of already worked on. So a lot of the stuff that they've done before was actually League of Legends. So they did a lot of lead characters, and so I kind of auditioned for like, you know, a bunch of random lead characters who had already been cast, but they just kind of wanted to see my range and like, and also auditioned for like some anime stuff, and they're like, okay, yeah, great, you did really well. And then I just kind of left, and that was it. A month later, they give me a call, they're like, congratulations, we want to cast you in Magi, the Kingdom of Magic. And so that was like my first named anime role. And ever since then, they've just like, I guess they don't hate me because they keep calling me back. So so yeah, so
that's good.
Sorry, that's a super like kind of in-depth answer, but that's like, I honestly think like all of that is really important, like how I kind of got started. I didn't just kind of like, you know, like jump in. I had like all this stuff behind me that kind of prepared me for it, I guess.
That's the thing, is that I always hear a lot of people saying that they want to be voice actors and stuff, and I think people forget that voice actors are full-time actors. That's what they do. They don't just do voice, but they do other things. Commercials, theater, you name it. I work with a variety of actors in Sentai Filmworks that are always doing something that's acting related. That's their full-time job. They live and breathe it.
Yeah.
That's what it is. And taking chances, even for audio engineering, it was taking a lot of chances and seeing where things led. And if you work at something hard enough, it's going to happen eventually. And you can't be shy. You got to be able to be friendly and talk to people and get out of that comfort zone and stuff and just put yourself out there. And that's what's going to get you anywhere really in life with whatever career you guys may choose.
Yeah, I think it's a lot of trial and error. You can't really be afraid to fail.
A lot of rejection.
Yeah,
that's okay.
Has there been a lot of times like where I've messed up or like ruined some huge opportunity? Yeah, probably. more times than I can count. Like huge things, you know. I mean, my mom was getting me in front of like Disney, and I had multiple callbacks. It's so funny, actually. My voice agent like called me up recently and was like, "Hey, we have a Disney opportunity for you." And I had like several callbacks, and this is on camera, right? And like, so that's the thing. She does only voiceover, but she knew this guy who like is casting for a thing at Disney. I had like multiple callbacks with Disney for an on camera thing recently. I haven't done on camera in so long, but I'm just like those weird opportunities just kind of like they just. They pop up and you just kind of gotta be prepared for them.
Yeah.
I wasn't. It was like on camera.
What do you learn from that?
Yeah. I'm like, what is this?
Yeah. Yeah. If you really want to be a voice actor and you ever get an audition, remember when you're in that booth and you have, 5-10 minutes, depending on how long the audition is, don't be scared to scream if your character has to scream. There's so many people that butcher an audition, they'll step in there, and like you will be a death scream or something. Like, ah, I'm dying. Oh. Ah! Yeah, it's those things that if your character is frustrated, you gotta scream, let it out.
Yeah.
Don't hold it back. A lot of people get really shy when they see the microphone in their face, and it's like, the first thing I always tell any person auditioning is like, it's cartoons. Have fun. I know you're really scared out there. Have fun. It's cartoons. Yeah. We want to make sure it's really hard. We have different processes. We don't have beeps over at So it's a lot of people that we have. They can. It's not a kind of can do it. It's you can either do it or you can't. It's all about your cold reads because we go so fast.
Yeah, but then it'll work for the most. But then there's like literally.
Be like, you're a zoo. You're our lucky dance monkey.
Yeah, no, it's you can't be shy. It's a lot of like putting yourself out there.
And then sometimes like the director will ask you to like do it a way that maybe doesn't even like work, but they just want to like see it. Like, what can you do? You know, like and like maybe it will work.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's just like trial and error. You know, like you gotta test a bunch of stuff. Just like not be afraid to do it. So
yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Practice also if you get a chance and you really want to do it, get yourself a cheap microphone or something and record yourself reading a book and try and act out. That's what I always recommend to new people starting out in this is open up a book and read and try and create a voice for every character that you're reading in that book and try and make it sound like believable.
Yeah.
And play it back, listen to it, see where your mistakes are, and then do it again, and perfection. You know, that's how you build perfection. It's a constant repetition of practice. 15 minutes a day is going to get you somewhere. That's what I used to do. I'm a musician. I play the violin, bass, guitar, and piano, and that's how I started. I didn't start creating masterpieces right away. It was, you know, the scales,
note by note,
figuring out where everything was until now I could play Eruption on my guitar, you know? That's how anything really works.
Like my piano teacher, like, screaming at me, just practice.
Yeah, when you're young, you're like, practice.
I know, it's like, right. I'm like, my mom's, I almost want to look at her, I'm like, my mom's making me do this. But I mean, I'm so glad that she did though, because now I can play about anything, you know, like read sheet music, and I know, like, I don't know, it's just kind of like, I just know it, you know? Right. Like, I don't really have to think about it. Like, sure, there are a few...
It's like learning a language.
Yeah, there's, like, sometimes there's, like, a few, like, advanced music theory things that I'm, like, I can't entirely remember because I got it, like, I learned it all when I was really young. Yeah. But then I'll just look it up and, like, kind of refresh. Oh, yeah, sure, I remember that.
Yeah,
that's cool. Yeah. Oh, I'm 19. Yeah, definitely one of the younger ones. That's why it was a little bit harder, I think, for me to get into the industry in LA, because then they also have like the labor laws over there, and you have to have like a special, usually you actually have to have a teacher on the set, and a booth is actually considered the set. Like, so a dubbing studio, usually they're working on like a tight budget. And if they want to bring me in, then they would have to have a teacher on the set. But what I actually did is I got a certificate where I graduated from high school early, so that I was able to not have to have a teacher on the set. And so then I would bring that with me just in case, like anybody came in and was like, hey, you know, why don't we have a teacher on the set? Oh, well, I'm graduated, so I don't need a teacher anymore. So that was one of the things I did, so that I was able to voice act when I was younger. I'm not sure how it works out here though, but I know
it's different everywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure about it because I'm old enough for everything now.
Yeah. Oh.
So you're an engineer?
Yes.
What's the biggest challenge of being an engineer that your general audience never understands? This is your time to let us down.
There's so many things. The hardest thing I would say for maybe perhaps working at Sentai Filmworks is we go faster than anybody else in the nation. Everybody else goes at around 25 to 30 cues an hour, I believe. Well, my record is 125 lines in 1 hour. That's how much I've edited.
You do one line at a time. Okay, wait, now do it like 5 different ways. Okay, none of those fit. We'll keep the first one. Now let's move to the second line. Yeah. 10 minutes of that.
At Sentai, our average is like 70 lines an hour or so. And the hardest thing will be the speed. When I started engineering, it was music. I was recording bands and all kinds of music, whether it was orchestral, big symphony, small, jazzy, metal, punk, you name it, everything. Then I realized I really wanted to do audio post, because I remember watching, it was a Pixar movie's Cars, and I was like, somebody has to add the sound of the engine and the tires and the ambience and all that. Who does that? Who's doing that? That is awesome. I want to find out. And I find out what audio post was, and I was like, I want to do that. And there seems to be more money in that too than recording bands and dealing with musicians. Jeez. voice actors are easier because it's just three people usually with us. It would be myself, the director, and the voice actor. And everybody, if you're a mean person, we're not going to hire you. If you're cocky, we're not going to hire you. We hire people that are nerds just like us and just want to make good cartoons. So everybody that you meet over at Sentai is pretty chill. They're really fun to talk to, really normal people, not going and stuff. But it would definitely be the speed. I remember the first time I sat in, I was with Stephen Foster, and he was the fastest at the time. And I remember sitting in for the first time, and I see the engineer doing it. I'm like, yeah, I can do that. I know all those keys. And I sit there, and everything just stopped. I'm like, oh God, what am I doing here? And I just remember something. Stephen was, he was a very, very honest and real person. And whether it was it came off mean or not, he was still like that. That's how he was. And I remember he just looks over at me and he's like, by the way, mediocre work, completely unimpressed. And I was like, oh. So I like challenges, so I took that as a challenge and I went home. A lot of people would have felt defeated there, but I was like, no, that's not going to stop me because I really want to do audiobooks. It's not going to stop it. So I went home that night and I remember just practicing my editing techniques and memorizing all the quick keys so that I wouldn't even have to look down or anything. And came in the second day, twice as fast. The third day, I got passed off and I became an actual contract engineer for them. And then like 6 months later, I got hired full time. And yeah, that was awesome. And I started doing like demons and monsters for any director that I did, because I'm really good at making nasty sounds with my throat.
Well, that's so cool because like in LA, I don't, like, I'm almost positive none of the engineers do any extra voices or any work like that at all. So that's like, that's really cool that you're able to like come in and do that. Not only do you get to, you know, like audio engineer the show, but like your voice is literally in it.
Yeah. So that's really weird. The first time, I don't know how you guys do it, because I don't consider myself a voice actor, but I like, if you look me up, I'm like every single show that's at the moment as some dad with some dude talking in the background or something. But the weirdest thing for me was hearing my voice. I hate my voice. I hate it.
Yeah,
I can't do it.
Yeah, no, I mean, like, I know how it is. It's like something you just gotta...
You gotta get past it.
And sometimes, like, sometimes you listen back to, like, I know I listen back to a lot of my shows, and I'm like, and I only critique myself and nobody else. Like, so I'm like, oh, everybody else is incredible, like, amazing, top tier, you know, 10 out of 10. And then I listen to my lines, and sometimes I'm like, ooh, could have done that differently. Oh, that sucked. Oh, why didn't I say that louder? Why is this too quiet? And it's just like that. But then sometimes you kind of have to put yourself in, like, in this other space where you just, like, watch the show, and then you're, like, able to enjoy it. Yeah. You know, like, you have to, if you're going to watch the show, like, you can't have that little person in your head, like, trying to, like, critique the heck out of yourself. You know, you just got to, like,
you got to keep going. It's watch what it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I remember, it started off where every single time I'll hear it, I'd be like, ugh. Now I hear it, I've gotten to a point where I change my voice purposely so that I don't cringe whenever I hear it. and it works out. I think most of the time whenever I'm watching shows that I worked on, I'm staring at the flaps. Like, how in sync it is. I'm like, man, I should probably move it a little bit, like, semi-frame to the left.
Yeah,
but
we're
like, perfect,
that. Yeah.
And then, like, also, like, if I mix the show, then I'm like, oh, I should have probably extended that delay just a little bit to carry it on and make it. So things like that is really weird. Yeah, I know. Watching movies is weird. It's very different for me now, because I'll watch them like, oh, they messed up there. Like, for example, The Dark Knight Rises, right? With Kane? No, Bane? I could barely understand what he was saying. I was very frustrated because I was like, you guys are Skywalker sound. You guys did Star Wars, and that's what you came up with? What the?
Gotta turn on the subtitles.
It wasn't until I actually bought the movie on Blu-ray and I watched those subtitles on that I completely understood the whole movie. and then I pay attention to things like there's a scene in the movie too where Batman gets tricked into getting into that railing or whatever by Catwoman, and Bane's behind him on the other side of the railing. And when you hear it, it sounds like Bane's like right behind Batman. So I was watching it, and then it turns to show Bane across the room. I'm like, what was that? Nobody else pays attention to that stuff.
Yeah.
Like, as an engineer, you gotta make sure that you add the distance, and that if they're across the room, then it should have some reflections in the room, and there should be a decay and a delay and all these things that make it believable to seem like the sound is very far away, because we're dealing with speakers and it's just a two-dimensional sound, and we've got to turn it into three-dimensional to make it believable. And if we've done a good job, you guys would never be able to tell that an engineer worked on it. Yeah. But anyways.
the stress of being an audio engineer and trying to like actually enjoy movies.
Yeah. But it's fun. Music, I can tell you how a drum set is mic'd up just by listening to a song, and I can hear that they've had two microphones for their overheads, a microphone for the kick, toms, and all that. I can tell you that that's all been mic'd up just by hearing 5 seconds, maybe. Yeah, it's weird, but it's a curse and a blessing because it makes something more enjoyable. I still don't like pop music, but I can appreciate the production value that they put in there.
Yeah,
because it's, man, some of these things that audio engineers do for pop music, like Ariana Grande, for example, whoever makes her beats, her music, is a genius. He's adding things that make it interesting to the listener no matter what. And pop music to me is, it's not fun because it's very repetitive, the 4-4, and then, okay, 4 beats here, new bar, 4 beats, and then, like, I can tell you when the chorus is coming in, when it's going to leave, and when the outro, and all that. And to me, that's boring. I want to be surprised as the listener. I want to have an experience listening to your song. But I will give them the credit that the production value is amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other questions about anything? Yeah. Favorite things to work on? You go first.
So, I like sound design, being able to work with just a blank canvas and creating everything. I got hired to do this indie project recently, and I'm doing all the sound design on it. I'm creating like laser sounds and cannons and, you know, and atmospheres and stuff. And that to me is the fun of audiobooks, is the sound design. And like for example, when you watch Star Wars, the TIE fighters, the lightsabers, all those sounds are so iconic that you just hear a second of it and you're like, that's a lightsaber, that's a TIE fighter. Yeah, any weapon is so iconic, and they take the time to make it very original and its own thing that there's so many space movies out there, you know, but nothing sounds like Star Wars, and that's probably why I'm kind of bored with Star Wars.
Do you like go into a room, like I've seen how they like kind of make some of these sounds, and sometimes like, for example, like I don't really know, like maybe like breaking a window, and then they, instead of like breaking like an actual window, they like they'll just take like a, I don't know, like a pane of glass or like some, or maybe even like a pot or something, and they'll just like smash it,
yeah,
and it'll sound like someone's like punching through a window,
yeah,
and they'll do something like that. Like do you go into like a room and kind of like do stuff like that, or bang like some pots together and make it sound like something, or like, or stomp around on like some like rocks or something, yeah, so it sounds like,
oh, you know, walking
on rocks.
Yeah, that would be the walking, the clothing, and that stuff. That's Foley artists, and I've done Foley myself. I've recorded it, I've obviously mixed it and stuff. But yeah, that would be the Foley. Then you have your other stuff like maybe wrecks and explosions and stuff, and that will require you to maybe have some white noise with pink noise, take out the high frequency, and then roll it off at the very end of the explosion to make that attack. And yeah, it's fun. It's an art.
Yeah,
I love that. So sound design would probably be, I think, the most fun that I've had. I saw this for Wally. So Wally, holy cow, yeah, Wally. If you have not seen Wally, watch it, if you've already seen it, watch it again, and pay attention to all the sounds, because the majority of the movie is just sound effects.
Yeah.
There's barely any dialogue. So the director and the engineers have to figure out a way to, if a robot squeaks, it has to mean something. The squeak has to be either happy, sad, confused, or something to carry on the scene. And it was really awesome. I did it. I remember watching some like behind the scenes things. I was trying to figure out how to create the perfect laser sound. And I want to say Ben Burr, I hope I'm not wrong with his name, but he's the sound designer for that movie and Star Wars and many other movies. And what he did for Eve's laser sound is he grabbed a and it was like a metallic sling. He held it from a ladder and stretched it down to a magnet, and he would strike it. And when you strike it, it makes the high frequencies travel faster than the low frequencies, so it creates like a every single time you hit it. I was like, that is awesome. And so I recorded that and then mixed it in with other stuff that I found out around, and then once I put it all together, it was awesome. I'm excited for this project when it comes out. It's gonna sound
wow, that's so cool. Yeah, I don't know, I think one of my favorite projects to work on was it's either like Gundam or One Punch Man. I think One Punch Man was really cool because not only was I like a fan of the entire show before I even got the chance to work on it, and after a very long and grueling callback process, we actually, it's so weird because nobody else, even in LA, nobody had really heard of it, but like four callbacks for an anime was very kind of like, not like, it's not heard of, or it's unheard of. So like just kind of like getting the role after going through that process, and then the Japanese approved it, and I felt like really good, you know. I was so happy that you know I got to be working on the show, and that, you know, working with Chris Kaysen, who's one of the chillest guys ever. We have this whole I have this story to tell, I guess, about some. Did I tell him about that? About the soda story? Maybe I did. So Chris Kaysen and I, so he's the director for One Punch Man, and we're working on like the Sea King episode where, you know, Genos is like fighting Sea King, and it's like really like kind of, you know, like he's just getting completely destroyed, and it's kind of like an emotional like thing, like lots of death sounds and screams and things like that. And so I'm getting ready to report. I'm super in the zone. I'm really serious. We watched the Japanese preview, and we're about to record. And so, you know, I just like get in my stance, my position. I'm like, I'm ready. I look at my lines. I know exactly how I'm gonna do it. And I wait for like 5 minutes, and nothing happens. No beeps. No. The screen doesn't play. And the thing is, when we record, there's a big wall of like of glass. You know, like right here, and then Chris and the engineer are in the other room. So I can technically see them, but I'm busy looking at the screen, kind of like away from them. Like I'm looking here, and they're like over here. So I don't really see like what's going on or anything. 5 minutes pass, nothing happens. I look over, and because they actually have to press the talk back button, right? They have to press the talk back button to talk to me so that I can actually hear what is going on in the other room. And nobody was pressing that button, so I had no idea what was happening. All I saw was Chris and the engineer were both like, and they were like, and that's all I see. And then they're like talking to each other, and I'm like, what is happening? And so I'm like, Chris, what's going on? Like, what's happening? And like, what are we doing? And he's like, I remember he like spins around in his chair. And he's like, oh my God, Zach. There's this peanut butter and jelly flavored soda that this intern just brought in, and you have to try it. And so it's so weird. He literally, and so it's so funny because we're on like recording time, right? Like you get paid by the hour. We're on recording time. We stop for like, I swear, like the entire day was like so unproductive. But we stopped for a really long time. He pours and we're just talking about this like stupid soda and how awful it was. So he pours the soda into the cup, and he brings it into the booth, and he's like, okay, try some of this stuff. And so I tried a little bit, and I'm like, this is the most disgusting thing I've ever tasted in my entire life. And so I'll tell you what it tastes like. Don't ask me how I would know how these other things taste that I will compare it to, but I just somehow know. But anyways, it tastes, it's like moldy bath water mixed with licking an old grandmother's like couch, you know? Like it's a little smoky, you know what I mean? Like smoky and moldy or something. It was like really, it was really weird. But yeah, no, I drank it, I took one little sip, was like, yeah, this is disgusting, I'm not gonna drink anymore. And so we kinda like, we talked a bit about like how bad it is. Like, who would make this stuff? Like, why is this even a thing? And so we start recording again, we do a few more loops, and I look over to the glass to, you know, just see like what's going on or whatnot randomly, and I see Chris Hasten still drinking the soda. And the engineer and I were just like, we are so baffled. We're like, why are you still drinking that stuff? Like, it's literally disgusting, like to the point like
we're so awful, it was good to
it was so bad. Well no, he pushes the talk back. I'm like, Chris, what are you doing? And he's like, oh well, you know how sometimes you'll try a food, but then you won't like it right away, but it's more of like an acquired taste, and I want to understand like why other people might like this. He's like, that's why I'm drinking it. And the engineer and I, we're just like so like done with him. We're just like, you are stupid. And so he continues to drink it, and I think he actually ends up like finishing the entire thing. And he's like, yep, that was disgusting. It's still disgusting. It was just, and so that kind of became like a thing we would bring in, like either we would do it or like an intern would do it. We would bring in like weird like, so, cause they had like a soda place like right down the street, and we would bring in like weird sodas that nobody had like ever tried before, and we would just bring them into the studio, and we would kind of like, we would you know, give them a little test. But that one was the worst one, I'll say that.
We've done stuff like that.
Yeah, I'm sure you guys have a lot of pass
around. When there's somebody goes to Japan, I can't remember who it is, but you go to Japan often, and they come back with like flavoring for water or something. And some of the flavoring, it's like squid flavoring for what?
Shrimp what? Flavored water.
Seriously? So every now and then, if we know the backers, like somebody that can handle it, then we'll before they come in, we always have like pictures and waters for them in the booth and stuff. There is a cup ready with water and stuff for their throat. And we'll sneak in a little bit of the flavoring in there and wrap it up. And so you'll see it, they're going to take a little sip and immediately, But yeah, no, it's awesome. We have to have some fun. We're inside like these caves for 8 hours a day, and so we have to find ways to have fun.
Did you have a question? Anybody? Okay, never mind. I'm seeing things.
Yeah. So are there any projects that you can't post about that you're working on?
Well, is... Is that camera over there filming? Oh, hey man, what's up? Hey, how are you?
We can, they'll.
Yeah.
We'll get drunk.
Yeah, I know, I was gonna let one slip there, but
I'll save you a sec, we can't.
let me think, like, well, there's a really cool, are you gonna...
Do you want me to cut it?
No, it's okay. I won't say it. There's a really cool show that I'm actually that I'm a big fan of. I'm glad I got to like be a part of. It came out last year, and it's about this dude kind of in like a magical place, and that's all I'll say. But I got to be a part of that show, and I don't play like the main character or anything, but I like just being able to be a part of it, because I remember watching the entire thing all the way through. Like usually when new anime comes out, sometimes I'll sample like a couple episodes here and there, but if I'm really interested in it, then I'll just watch the entire thing and just like kind of love the show and then cry later when we don't get to work on it, because you know, like you guys get it out here or something. But there's a show.
Yeah, that does happen. There'll be a show that I'll hear about, like, man, I really want to work on that freaking thing.
Yeah.
And then I'm so excited because I feel like we're gonna get it, and then I find out somebody's got it. One show that I did work on recently that's already out, Sakamoto. I didn't know if I was gonna like it. I remember watching it, and I was like, this is different, and it's funny, and it's weird, and I like it. And then we started recording it, and I just remember the lines being just like, really? That's the show? Oh my god, I love this. And when you watch it, the show is so obnoxious, and it knows it is obnoxious, and it does a really good job of keeping it funny and weird throughout the entire time. And like, you forget that they're high schoolers, and it's so dramatic in some situations where it makes it sound like they're like 30-year-olds or something like that, but they're just high schoolers. And then like they come back to that, oh yeah, wait, we're just in high school, man. They make fun of everything. I think they even make fun of us as Americans. And the very last episode, everybody's got like a bigger nose. They have a black coach, and for the majority that's always there, he's one of the characters. And at the very end, they have the same versions of the characters, but the American versions. And so they have another black coach with like fatter lips and shaved head, and the dudes are like dressed like greasers. They got the pompadour style and everything. Oh my god, if you haven't seen that show, it is awesome. It's hilarious. You're gonna like it.
That sounds cool. Well, I guess there's one thing I want to promote is Skip Beat. Anybody's ever seen Skip Beat? Yeah, Skip Beat like just finally got an English dub, which is absolutely amazing. And I got to be a part of it. I got to play like a younger version of one of the main guys when he's like telling some stuff. His little like code name is like Corn or whatever. There's lots of like random corn puns in the show. It was really weird because I originally went in for like Wawa, and then they called me back like a couple more times like, hey, your character had more lines, and I was like, okay, cool. And then like, but it doesn't like show the, like you wouldn't know like who he is really unless you watch the show, which I'd seen the entire show already, because like I love Skip Beat. I thought it was like, I don't know, it was just kind of like inspiring, I think, as an actor to watch, because it's kind of like about like an actress, like you know, her boyfriend's like leading her on, he's like a big jerk, and he like, and he's an actor, and he like pretty much like she's doing everything for him, and then he like dumps her, and then she's like, okay, well, you know, freaking, I'm gonna become an actor now and like, you know, show you what's up. And so like, so then she kind of like becomes an actor, you know, out of nowhere.
What's the new show?
Skip Me. Skip Me. It's a really cool show. Yeah, yeah. Oh, what time is it? Yeah, you can. Oh, hi. All right, wait, are you guys next?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, cool.
Okay. 3 minutes?
Okay, let's ask more questions. Oh, yeah. Yuri Lowenthal. Yuri Lowenthal is one of my favorites. You know, watching Naruto when I was younger. I don't know, sometimes I'll do a line and I'll be working in a booth with a director who's worked with Yuri, and they're like, you know what, that line you just did reminds me of Yuri. And I'm like, it's just like the biggest, you know, compliment I could possibly get. I'm like, that's like, I don't know what to say to you, but thank you. Like, I hope I get to work with Yuri. When I was younger, I was a huge fan of Ben 10. I loved watching like Ben 10 and Ben 10 Alien Hurt. Of course, was the one where Yuri like started playing Ben, so that was it was really cool. It's like, it's hero time.
I'm horrible with names, so I can't remember. I'm sorry, I'm so bad with remembering names. But there's an actor that pretty much did all the voices for the clones in Star Wars Clone Wars, the 3D cartoon thing. He's also done voices for Platypus. Yeah, he's not voicing that. He does, I can't remember his name, but I like actors that have...
Oh, it's Dean Bradley Baker.
Yes.
Anyway, it's like all the animal noises, he's incredible.
Yeah. Somebody that can do that with their throat and mouth. I mean, he'll like talk about going into certain chambers of his face and his throat and making that big squeal like more, you know, more gruesome and stuff, and he does it perfect. And I wish I could do it. I don't know how this guy even begins to do it. And not only that, but he sounds different for every character. It's not the same voice.
Yeah.
That is an art. The voice actors that can do that, that can throw their voice around and completely sound 100% different than their own voice, that is very difficult to do. And I love anybody that can do that.
And if you don't know who, if you guys have ever seen Avatar, The Last Airbender, he plays Appa and Momo. So he does all those like sounds, I don't know, like he does that, and then he does the like little high thing. I don't know how he does that. I mean, I've seen like videos of him doing it, and I'm like,
yeah.
I'm like, how do these sounds come out of this man? You know, like it's like, it does not make any sense. He's so good.
Yeah, it's always different, always unique.
Where can we find you online?
Oh, you can find me at on Twitter at Airzach, A-I-R. Z-A-C-H. I like Michael Jordan, so Air Jordan, Air Zach. You can find me, my website, ZachAguilar.com, Instagram, Zach Aguilar, Facebook, Zach Aguilar, voice actor. If you type my name into Google, I'm pretty sure these things will come up.
I'm pretty low-key online. I should start doing more stuff, but at RJC_Rick, that's my Twitter, and that's pretty much what I do, and everything else is kind of like family and friends and stuff, but also the same thing for Instagram. You can catch me on there and look at pictures I post. But I need to start doing more stuff like that.
You should do it, especially, I mean, like, I don't know, like, people love to kind of like see.
Because I love seeing how I'll follow celebrities myself. I'm a huge Slipknot fan, and I follow all those dudes in the band and stuff and see what they're doing and see what they're
doing. Yeah.
I'm going to do it.
I'm going to follow you through.
Oh, I guess we're going to wrap this panel up, so
it's
slow.